as a child, I have always been very enamored and wondered and curious as what were the linguistic influences and the nuances that shaped some of the words that I used as a child in my home and what I used in school when I was talking English and learning English. And it has always prompted me to think as I grew older that maybe words do travel a lot. They travel far and wide. And the context of their travels may have something to do with nuances from history, geography, and culture.
Like all of my cousins and stuff, that we always go on trips and stuff like that. 2 years ago, went to Switzerland, Austria, Germany. And I tried to speak a little bit of German when I was there. Like every sort of country is just like a little bit different. Even if they're technically like they have the same dialect, it's just a little bit different. Like I could understand pretty much for the most part, like everything that they were saying. There would be like a couple words where I wouldn't understand, or like it wouldn't fit in the sentence, like how I learned it.
I'm from Bavaria. So Bavaria has a very heavy dialect. Ich gehe heim. I go home. In Bavarian, I would say ich gehe heim. So which doesn't really sound like it anymore. Well, Bavaria is divided up in counties, and even the counties have different accents. So I'm from the Oberpfalz. So I have certain words I pronounce differently than the person maybe 20 miles towards the west, because they are from Franken. So they have another special, like almost like a different twang. Now my sister's been living in Vienna, Austria for the past 20 years, and she has a very, very distinct Austrian accent, which is kind of strange to me because she's been my sister forever, you know, and she's German. So it's odd for me to kind of hear her speak like an Austrian person.
My grandma is from the west and my opa is from the east. He actually escaped when the wall was first being built, but my mom always tells me, oh yeah, they have totally different accents. And I'm like, I can't tell that they have different accents. And then, but we have other family that's from a totally different region, but I can tell that their accents are different.
Well, and I'm not even a good example of South Central Kentucky English because I was educated by teachers who were learning to be teachers, and they were all from the north. But my dad was from Eastern Kentucky in the Appalachian area, where the lights shine bright at night. And so people would look at us and they'd say, is she adopted? Because I didn't talk that way.
I grew up in the Philippines. In the Philippines, we learn English side by side with Filipino from kindergarten. So, and our medium of instruction is English. Our official language and business is English. So it's not unusual. We call it the Taglish. Day-to-day conversation is a combination of Filipino terms in English. And then when we start working, especially, like I said, official language, there's a lot of dialects in the Philippines. So when people congregate from different regions, they mostly communicate in English because none of us know the other dialect.
Both of my parents are Honduran. So Honduran Spanish is a little bit different than Mexican Spanish.
There's a tone difference and some words vary. So it's just a way of how you would pronounce it or talk to someone, I guess you can say.
Growing up, we would go to a lot of different places where there'd be a lot of different Latin American people from different parts of Spain, Mexico, whatever, Puerto Rico. And I was in line one time waiting it was a buffet line, and the lady walks up to me and she goes to me, con permiso, ¿me puedes dar champú? Well, I looked at her and I was like, she said, can you give me shampoo? And I was like, I was younger. I said, shampoo? I looked at my mom. I said, Mom, this lady wants shampoo. She goes, no. She tells me in Spanish, son, that means excuse me from Puerto Rico. I was like, oh. I said, yeah. I told her, yeah, no problem. First time I had ever heard somebody say, con permiso, me das shampoo.
I'm from Vientiane, so I'm capital. Okay. I'm in the capital, so I'm in the city. But then if you go to the South, they're Southern speaking. And then, you know, it changes wherever you go. So the accent and everything. Because my dad, he's from the South. Okay. Like, but he was raised in the South.
Okay.
Until he was like a teenager. But he left and stayed in Vientiane. You can't even tell he's from the South. Because he speaks the Vientiane. He has a Vientiane accent. They're like, are you sure you're from Paksay? Because Paksay is Southern. And that's how, you know, it's like, you know, here in the U.S., if you move to the city since you were nine, you know, from Mississippi or something, you don't have that Mississippi accent. They always say, like, when you travel to Thailand, you want to lose your Lao. Yeah. You know, when you work in Thailand, they try to speak like Thai people or have the Thai accent and stuff. So that changes as where you live or go. Yeah.
Grandma always used to pronounce water like water. Like, what was with that? Like, she grew up in the Ozarks, and my mother says, well, I think it might have had something to do. She had grown up in the Ozarks. She had a Southern accent, and when they moved to Michigan, she was teased by people about her Southern accent, and she thinks that this was like some kind of overcompensation to correct for that. So I've always remembered that.
People in England, they say water. And that's the same back home, it's water, but over here it's water, if that makes sense. So that's the great difference right there. I remember one time me and my friends were playing soccer when I moved to the States, when we went over to McDonald's to eat something. He was asking for water. He was up there for a good minute, just water, water. And that's where you can see the accent coming up. But, you know, I guess the words are more pronounced, if that makes sense. And that's the gray. It's not so much gray right there. It's more clear over there in that scenario.
Yoruba is an ethnic group in Nigeria. But I can tell you that in Nigeria we have over 270 ethnic groups. And despite the fact that I am a Yoruba man, there are other Yoruba guys that might not understand what I'm saying. It could be because of the intonation or the dialect. I'm from the Southwest, specifically, I'm from the Oyo Axis. And in the Oyo, I could come up to say, Ekaaro, that's good morning. Some other Yoruba areas, theirs might be Okun, awesome. Our lingua franca in Nigeria is British English, which is a bit different from the American English. Yeah, so I speak English. You go to school where you are taught in English, so you are expected to understand British English. But there's another form of English in Nigeria, or I think it's peculiar to West Africa, but we call it the Pidgin English. The Pidgin English, you might be a white man. If I speak the Pidgin English now, you might not understand it. If I want to say, Prof, I want to eat. The British English, I might say, Prof, I want chocolate. You know? So if you didn't grow within that community, that locality, you might not understand what I'm saying.
In Cameroon, you learn the same English. When I came out here, it's pretty much the same. But I think the Pidgin is more for the grandparents, the older generations. That's what they grew up speaking. Like when I call my grandma back home and we're having a conversation, sometimes she tells me to stop speaking and speaking American, like, you know, talk like how I would talk back home. So if I'm having a conversation with her, so she's asking, what am I doing? She would say, no way to you to do. So what am I doing? It's like, no way to you to do. And then, how are you? Is just the same, you know, how are you doing? Or how are you? And it's just, sometimes you have to be speaking with the other person or maybe in a conversation for it to come out, if that makes sense. But it's usually just rearrange, like where are you going? No way to go. So nah is often like the best way to like start a sentence, if that makes sense. So no way to go. Nah how you be. Nah how you to do.
Because I'm a part of the LGBT community, I know that I tend to use more feminine presenting words to talk about people in ways that like men may not usually say. So like if I call one of my friends that's a girl hot, a lot of people might be like, does that mean something else? But to me, that just is my way of presenting to them that I think that they look good or that they are attractive. I think it kind of does have to do with that gender binary that in masculine groups and groups of guys, you kind of see them and kind of in heterosexual settings, referring to women as like hot or beautiful or things like that. So it's almost kind of like interacting in that kind of way without it, obviously, with those people knowing how I identify myself, that they don't interpret those words the same ways that they might interpret them from somebody else.
Well, if you're lying to my mom or to any of my relatives in Scotland, they have a particular phrase about that. They say, "Your bum's out the window," which literally means your butt's out the window. Now, that's one of the beauties of language, and Scottishisms are English, and they're not English. But idioms do not translate very smoothly into back into English. So that's one of my favorites. So my father's from Southern Illinois. Very different world. I'm a combination of Southern Illinois and Scotland, which probably means I'm insane. My dad used to always tell me, whatever else you do, son, don't only love what you do, because he always preached that, but he said, whatever you do, please promise me that you're not going to be another ass in the mass, or my favorite, another turd in the herd. And so every time I think maybe my dad's looking down on me and saying, you're kind of messing up there, I think, oh my God, I'm a turd in the herd.
Ponte las pilas, usually that means like when my parents used to tell me that, you know, I really wasn't doing so good, you know, when I was little in school. And they'd be like, ponte las pilas, you know, meaning like you gotta do well in school. It doesn't translate equally, but basically if you want a direct translation, it's put on your batteries. Yeah.
One idiom that I think is really funny to mean, like, to embarrass yourself is siest v lužu, which means to sit in a puddle. So it's like, oh my gosh, I totally embarrassed myself. It's like, I sat in a puddle.
¿Dónde pirijitos? It's like, that's a type of bird. It's like, they're very, those types of birds are like, like kiss a lot. People say that when they see, like, couples, like, making out a lot.
Esa persona le está poniendo mucha crema a sus tacos. So the exact translation would be, that person is putting too much sour cream on their tacos. But in Spanish, everybody understands that, you know, they're like, oh, he's laying it on kind of thick.
We would say in this country, that person's putting on airs. My mom would say, she's Lady Muck Fisturi Castle, which literally means she's Lady Dirt of Dusty Castle.
Well, I did say, like, if somebody else is talking smack, yeah, or they're talking, like, something that doesn't make sense or something bad about you, in Honduras, they say hablando lata. It's literally like talking can. Like, lata is a can, but they say hablando lata.
Grün hinter den Ohren means green behind the ears. Being inexperienced or somebody hat den Schuss noch nicht gehört, hasn't heard the shot yet, which means you haven't grasped it yet. Or das ist mir Wurst, that sausage to me means I don't care. Die Nase voll haben, to have the nose full, being fed up with something. Oder jemanden auf den Keks gehen, to go on someone's cookie. You are annoying. That's what that means.
When you're extremely happy, you say petao, which means I'm flying. So it means I'm petao ptiharamu, or I'm flying out of my happiness. So we say petao when we're really happy, extremely happy.
My mama would say to me, Melinda, your tongue's so sharp, you must have had razor soup for lunch today. And so that was said to me quite often. One that I say all the time is good gravy. So that's my expression because good gravy was said around my house a lot. And Lord willing and the creek don't rise. One that was said too is, well, he must be stretching the blanket. And that meant exaggerating a story.
One of my professors in Santiago was talking to me about when she lived in the States. And she had lived here for, I think, at least a couple years. And she had really grown fond of the culture, grown fond of many of her friends, her roommates. And she had to leave. She had to go back home. And while she was happy to go back and see her family and friends in Chile, she was very sad to be leaving her friends here in the States. And one of the roommates came up to her and said, Carolina, are you leaving for good? And she's like, no, I'm leaving for bad. And again, the American had to explain, no, our expression, are you leaving for good, means, Are you leaving permanently? And Carolina's like, then why do you call it good when I'm so sad about this? What is good about this? Again, another example of something idiomatic that just does not translate.
So I'm a biologist by training, so let me start with something biology-oriented. One of the things I was thinking of was a monsoon rainforest kind of a plant or a tree, right? And I don't want to say the word yet. It is an evergreen, fast-growing tree that grows really tall and has a very large canopy, and it is called the ficus. So everywhere in the world, it is called the ficus. That's the botanical name. But we all know it by the name banyan tree. And the word banyan tree came linguistically is because it's such a large canopy tree around these spaces in India. So as people were walking by, there is a group of merchants called the Baniya. And these merchants, Baniya, were having their trades under this large canopy tree. And people walked by, and linguistically, it started to be called the banyan tree.
And also in my language, one word, like, can mean 10 different things. So there's this spelling, O-K-O. So there's oko, it means a hoe. You know, they use it on the farm. Yes. And then there's oko, it means husband. There's Oko, it means farm.
The one thing I remember about this one is it came from the word English word social. We say pasosyal, pasosyal siya, or she's putting on airs, or she's, you know, making herself look good because, you know, different societies, especially, you know, people who are rich, there are people who say pasosyal siya, it means that they're trying to imitate rich people. And then when I was in college, it is required for us to take 2 years of Spanish. And a lot of the Filipino terms is rooted in Spanish. So there's a lot of terms. So up to this point, even though I haven't spoken in Spanish in a long time, I can still see signs, read it, and probably understand 50% of it because of the commonality in the terms.
French, like the Romance language, is masculine-feminine based. So if you change from le or la, the masculine-feminine, you may be saying a whole different word, so your sentence may make no sense, or you may be saying something completely different.
So when my students are thinking about, and they're confused about misconceptions in biology, in my mind, I think of this word called khichdi. And khichdi is a word. It's a concoction. It's a food. It's lentil, rice, vegetables, spices mixed together. And you just throw it in an instant pot and run it for 15 minutes and your food's ready. So it's used in a phrase like this. The khichdi that you're creating right now in your conversation is really destroying the ambience of this room.
Spanish lately, especially like and my people my age has been really influenced by Puerto Rican culture and like Caribbean culture. So they have like crazy phrases that I don't want to say, but it's more modernized. Like it's stuff that you hear like in rap music or in like, it's called reggaeton, which is basically like a mixture of Spanish and hip hop.
The other one I was thinking was jungle, right? So when you think of jungle and you think about Rudyard Kipling and the Jungle Book and Balu the Bear and all of that stuff, the jungle comes from the Sanskrit word, which is jungle. J-A-N-G-A-L, jungle. And jungle means arid land. So in some ways, Rudyard Kipling's book about all of this was talking about the jungle, not as in a forest full of animals, but in some way it has been twisted over time, but jungle as in arid space, which is sort of deserted, and there is only some shrubs growing in there.
I do have a language story. This took place in 2017 when I was at another institution teaching a class called Language, Grammar, and Society. And part of the class was explaining where the English language came from. As we were working on this, these students eventually said, why don't we create our own language? They took my example of the word goodbye, which is first recorded in English around in the mid-16th century, coming from the phrase, God be with you. And that implies in communication that the person hearing that, first of all, understands the concept of God and knows that the wish is a good wish, that they will be watched over and protected. So there's a lot of story behind that one word. And I said, you need to be doing the same with your words. The college they were attending had just announced they were closing. And it was all, everything they had been working towards as students at that particular location was all going to be gone. And they were essentially going to be a displaced people. And that's where the language started coming from. So they were trying to work on a particularly prickly noun for the time, a noun for home. And they were having a not so great time, so they thought of the word sheol in Hebrew, meaning the place of the dead. They've been sent away to someplace not nice, but they want to turn a positive spin on it. And they knew that the letter A has a lot of great connotations in English, particularly American English. That's A number one, or that's grade A. So they turned it to an A sound, and home became Aella. So they felt good. The same way when we hear the word home, that communicates a message, a rhetorical subtext of, okay, I feel pretty good. I feel pretty good inside. And so hopefully that's what they want to communicate with that word. And I also had them thinking about, well, it's good that you're coming up with all these nouns, but what about your conjunctions? What about verbs? How do you say something happened in the past? And they, after a while, said, this is hard. And I said, uh-huh. Yeah, it shows how much communication happens that we do automatically without thinking about.
There was a generation, my great-grandfather and my friend's buddy, who always seemed suspicious that we had something cooking that was going to end us up in prison or something. So Grandpa Chuck, with my great-grandfather, every now and then, if you got close enough to him, he'd smack you on the shoulder, hard. I said, Grandpa, what was that for? And he said, something you'll do later. And my buddy Paul, I'd go pick him up on a weekend night or something, and we were heading out to do whatever. And his father always thought we were up to no good, too. So as we're leaving the house, his phrase was always, not tonight, boys. Not tonight. And that just stayed with you enough to say, we weren't planning anything. In fact, we never, ever, ever got caught doing anything bad.
My grandpa used to tell me ponte abusada, which kind of is the same thing as ponte las pilas. Just basically means, like, know yourself, know what you're doing at all times. It also applies to, like, when I'm driving. He literally just told me this the other week, too. I was just there. He was like, ponte abusada cuando andes manejando, like, be wary of what's going on around you when you're driving. Yeah.
So one saying that I've heard before, they say in Greek, "Sukufu timporta oso thelis brodar." And what that means is you can knock as much as you want at a deaf person's door. And why we say that is you say that to someone who's stubborn, someone who doesn't listen.
Well, whenever my mom was angry at me when I was growing up, she always threatened me by saying, I'm going to bop you up one side of the head and doon the other. Which literally means I'm going to hitch up one side the head and down the other. But she'd say, I'm going to bop you up one side the head and doon the other. So I don't think I know anyone else's whose parents threatened them with that particular form of abuse.
So my grandfather had some particular pearls that were very interesting. There was a phrase that he would say if someone would want more than what was there. It was, oh, what do you want, an egg in your beer? Which that's supposed to be, oh, what a treat. You have the egg in your beer as well. But I can't imagine that was very appealing. So I don't know where that comes from.
It's like besa, my mom said. It's kind of an older word, and it's like beyond a promise. Like if you say somebody, you have my besa, you basically say like you would sacrifice oneself just to keep your besa, just to keep your promise. But it's like a beyond a promise. Like you definitely don't give this on the regular. You only pull this out, and you definitely are like telling somebody like, whatever this is, I'm gonna do it for you, even if I have to sacrifice oneself.
So, like, if there's someone that you're not fond of and you don't want to go talk to them, or you just, like, whatever. So my mother-in-law would say, you know, go talk to them. And she would say, "Then sutroi topsomi." They're not going to eat your bread. So it's kind of like, don't be afraid. Like, it's okay to go talk to them.
My father is older, and he'll be turning 89 here this June. So he was in his 50s when I was in high school, and he was using antiquated phrases. I'm no spring chicken, so high school was a long time ago. And even then, they were antiquated. For example, to describe someone in authority that is somewhat putting on airs, he would use the phrase, "his nibs." Meaning, I'll use it in a sentence. His nibs wants things organized to his liking. And I would sit there, what the hell does that mean? What is his nibs? Yeah, and even then it was antiquated, so I realized it was just that, someone who he viewed as pompous or puffed up. He would also, when he was frustrated, use this word, fooey. And even that, you don't hear it anywhere today, and he didn't even hear it that much at the particular time, but it's basically a very, not even a swear word, just a sign of consternation. I don't know where it comes from, but he's the only person I've heard say it.
If somebody's cheap with money, they say, "Oh, es bien codo," which literally means, oh, they're very, like, elbow. Yeah, so if somebody's like, oh, they're trying to say, oh, they're very cheap with money, then they just go like this. And another one, like, all Hispanics know this, you know, like, pointing to something, you just point with your lips, like, like that.
If this ends up in Filipino book, in jokes about Filipinos, we point with our lips. So when we say, "Over there," we don't point with our finger, we go, "Dun."
So gestures like this means yes, or like, "That's okay," or like, I mean, it's a very multi-purpose gesture. But like, my mom used to use it all the time when she was on the phone talking to an aunt or something, and I wanted to go to a friend's house. I would like ask her, like mouth the words to her, and she would be like this, and it'd be like, "That's fine, you can go ahead."
So when you say yes, you say "ne." And the nonverbal way of doing "ne" is just a head down. And to say "no," we say "ohi," or we do a head nod up, and we make a sound too. We say, so we do our head up and we make a sound with our mouth.
French people, or like French speaking people, they use a lot of facial expressions. So sometimes they won't even say yes or no. They'll just be like, "no," or like, it's like, I know a lot of people make fun of French people because of that, but like, even if you're disgusted, you'd be like, but they just won't speak instead of that.
If I want to show you that I'm happy, if you give me something, I'm happy with it, I can say, could be expression. I might not have the exact words that tells you that I'm happy with what you're giving me.
When we greet an elder, instead of just saying hi, hello, we hold our hands and we put it in our forehead. We call it mano, which is hand, by the way.
If you know someone, you might walk up to them and actually faire les bises, okay? So this is only really in French-speaking countries that they actually greet someone with a bis. A bis is regional, in the sense that in Paris, a bise is two kissing noises. So you put your cheeks together and you would kiss, make a kissing sound. You do not kiss each other. You just make a little sound, and then you switch to the other side and you touch the two other cheeks together, and you would also make a kissing sound. If you go to the south of France, then they're gonna have four. So you would alternate back and forth for four kissing noises. If you go to the northern areas, Brittany and that, they would do three. It's very regional. So they can kind of play a joke on you and tell where you're from or if you're a foreigner, depending on if you know how to faire les bises or if you know how many.
I guess like Belgians, they're really, really close to your skin. And then Mexicans, it's just kind of like a tap, like you just tap them. But like Belgians, they like kiss you. And then I noticed from Afghanistan people, Afghans, they like straight on like kiss.
And thank you to we bow. So let's say I'm giving something to an adult or an adult give me something, I'll say thank you. Or I'm greeting an adult, I have to go down, a chief, a king. I have to go down to greet or to say thank you. Yes, that's a sign of respect. We use this a lot for a lot of stuff. After prayer, we pray in Ghana, the kids, you see everybody will do this. So the moment we say we are going to pray, every child will do this.
Kia, kia, kia is fast. So at times I might not use the gesture, but it has become a part of most of us. I won't just say, shekia, kia, kia, kia. To me, I'm not actually eating what I want. So I want the hand to go with it. Shekia, kia, 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 kia.
Non-descriptive means if you do this, you mean du hast einen Vogel, you have a bird, meaning you're crazy.
So a bird
stupid.
In the head means you're crazy.
Yeah, probably you're cuckoo. Maybe that's how it relates to.
So this, I don't know if you got, like, this means F you.
Right.
I don't know if it's appropriate. I don't know what you would approve, but as kids, we would get mad and be like, nah.
If you're working like in electrical and whatnot, I noticed this a couple weeks ago when we were working with trying to diagnose faults within the trainers that we have. There was one specific fault we had where like the normally open contacts were welded, they were welded shut. Pretty much what that means in English terms was that with this specific circuit that we were working on, the contacts, like there were like these two lights. And normally like when the circuit was properly working, you would flip both switches and then both lights would be on. But in this case, with this circuit, when you activate the power button, both of them were already on, and no matter which switch you flipped, they were both on. No, none of them would turn off. So that means they're technically welded shut.
Conducting a concert band, I'm on the podium, and the musicians are all in front of me. Let's take it back from the top, and give me more dynamics this time. Let's also make sure, let's get more of that retardando going into the last eight bars from the end. Basses, make sure you don't drag on the last phrase. Let's play the piece of music from the very beginning and make more of the loud and soft contrasts this time. Let's also slow down more in that slower section right before the last eight measures of the piece. Low instruments, make sure you don't slow down on that last short section of music.
One part you're going to need is a 1 inch by 1 inch by 2 foot angle iron and then a 1 inch OD pipe by 2 feet. You're going to use the butt weld and stitch the two pieces together every inch. And then you'll check the blueprint for tolerance and specifications. No, you basically put the two pieces together and weld them two different ways according to the instructions.
I'm in the Army and then I'm an MP. I'm a military police officer. So we have like a rank system. So like I'm a specialist, that's an E4. So when you're around other specialists, it can be relaxed and lean back. But then once you hit a certain rank, they become officers and you just have to show a sign of respect, which is weird because somebody your age could be an officer. So you either have to like stand you say parade rest, like you stand with your hands behind your back like this. And you have to talk to them in a formal manner and you have to call them by their rank. And similar to like Mexican culture, like you can't interrupt people ever. It's so disrespectful. So you have to wait until the conversation's over. You have to stand there with your hands behind your back as a grown woman speaking to people your age. So it's really weird like switching back from soldiers to civilian because you feel like you're super disrespectful. Like sometimes I wait around a lot. That's something I do a lot. I wait around. My mom's like, what are you waiting for? I'm like, well, I'm waiting for them to be done. She's like, just go ask them. It's just like, I feel like I'm being rude all the time now.
There's a phrase I've seen in various forums called, if you're in the middle of doing a solo, just dime bag it. And what that means is, if anybody hasn't heard of Pantera, dime bag Daryl, what he would do is with guitars that have a whammy bar on it, he would dump the bar to get like the strings all flubby
and then he would hit a natural harmonic, and then he would, like, quickly flip the bar back to give it this nasty high-pitched squeal. It's pretty crazy technique once you get it down, because then once you do it, you're doing it, like, every 5 seconds, but you have to learn to control it, because when you hit it, it just really makes it pop, and it brings your solos to a whole new level.
That's a good question. I think I had not the most typical experience with this, because most of my friends were all multilingual in Russia. So depending on the circumstance, they would maybe say bless you. A lot of them would say Gesundheit. I don't know if that's a common thing, but I know a lot of them lived in Germany, so.
Gesundheit, which actually interesting misconception about that. A lot of people who speak English think that means good health, but it literally just means health. Gesund, like without the height at the end, means healthy. So height along with kite is a suffix that means like ness. It would be like equal to English's N-E-S at the end of a word, so.
If you end up sneezing, we say schnet, meaning health. And that person in return would say schnet patch, health back to you.
We say bele, bele means sorry. Yeah, so we don't really say bless you, like bless you in my language. We just say sorry, bele.
Bless you.
Bless.
I usually say bless you.
Yeah, so we say life, unkwa, meaning we pray for long life for you. So if a baby sneezes, every adult around there will say unkwa, life. So you say bless you, but we don't say bless you. We say yemautinkwa, we're giving you long life.
It's kind of slang, because that's the only one I hear. They go, si ma, which is very slang. So I don't really want to translate it. But if somebody was loud listening or hearing this, they would understand.
We've never said anything, so I had to double check with my mom. But she said, we don't say anything. We don't say anything. We don't say Gesundheit or bless you or nothing.
I think part of that goes with the, well, with the other things or some of like superstitions or like religious type things, I think. Yeah. But yeah, there's no bless you or anything. No.
Okay. If somebody sneezes, you'd be like, oh, salud. It's just like bless you.
Yeah.
Salud also has a different definition too. So if you wanted cheers for like drinks, you would say salud. Okay. So it definitely is the context on how you say things. Yeah.
Okay, in Spanish, it's just salud, which translates literally to health. Yeah. And in French, it's à tes souhaits, which is to your good wishes.
The one that always stands out to me the most is I love you. I love you, to me, is something I would use for my kids, I would use for my husband. It has a strong meaning behind the words I love you. But in Spanish, it's te amo. But te amo means so much more than just I love you. There are some words in Spanish that have so much more meaning behind them than you can actually say in English. So sometimes I catch myself talking to my parents or my husband and I have to use them in Spanish because there's not something as strong to be able to translate it to English.
Chula, right? So that would be like they're good looking. So like you can also say bonito or bonita. I mean, that's pretty direct translation to beautiful. But chulo is more like slang. Like I don't know what a English equivalent would be to something like that. Maybe cute, but cute has a different Spanish word, which is lindo. So chulo really exists in like its own thing. And it can be, you know, like you could tell it to your kids, like you're being really cute, or you can, you know, you can mean it in like a really like sexual way if you're really attracted to somebody. So there's like a wide range of uses.
I studied in a few countries down in Latin America. My Spanish, I hope to get back there again, but one Chileanism, it's in no Spanish dictionary, is the word pololo. Pololo is the step down from novia or novio. So, you know, boyfriend, girlfriend, you've probably been dating for a while. At least a few weeks, a month, whatever. You're not as serious as fiancé, you're definitely not married. But the Chileans have one level beneath that, so it's right above, hey, we're just buddies, we're just pals, to, well, we've gone on a date or two. I don't know if this is boyfriend or girlfriend status, but it sure doesn't feel like buddy and pal.
There's a couple, but one of the ones that stand out mostly would be con huevos. For con que ese tiene muchos huevos, so it'd be like, that guy has a lot of eggs, but that makes no sense. But we're saying he's brave and ballsy in a way.
¿Qué onda? ¿Qué onda? I guess the exact translation is be what wave, but really what you're asking him is what's going on. You're like, hey, ¿qué onda? Or I could say, ¿qué pasión? ¿Qué pasión means another word for what's going on, but in English the exact translation is what passion. But that's not what I'm asking them. I'm asking them, hey, what, you know, what's going on around here? What's, you know, what's up? What's the word?
I feel like you could say something simple like, me siento mal, I don't feel good, like I feel bad. But there are some like more like slangy terms for it. So the first one's me siento la patada. La patada means like kick, like a kick, right? So me siento la patada. I'm sure the whole phrase used to be something like me siento como alguien me dio un patada, like I feel like somebody kicked me. But over time, I'm sure it's shortened to just I feel like kick, like someone kicked me.
So my girlfriend is a first generation Filipino. So her parents came over to immigrated to America in, I want to say, mid to late 80s. And I've been picking up some words in Tagalog from them. And one that has always stuck with me is baon. And as I understand it, it's like the leftovers that you bring for lunch. You know, if we have leftover food or her family has leftover food, then it's be like, oh, you can take some of this for baon.
This word actually ended up in an article that I came across in Pocket. It's word gigil. It's the kind of feeling that you have when you like you find something cute, especially a baby, and you want to go, you know, you're going like this and you're trying, you want to pinch the baby's cheeks or legs and you're kind of like so excited. It's called giggle.
My mother would say, she'd say, oh, you have a rock head. I'm like, rock head? And then I figured out, like, it means stubborn, but the expression is ganko atama. And I would be like, rock head?
Honigkuchen preferred, which is literally means word for word. Honey cake horse, which I think is like a really big giddy smile, like when someone has a really big stupid smile on their face that they just can't turn off. The German word Afa means monkey, but it also means ape, so they don't really have two separate words for that to distinguish between those two different things.
Streichholzschachtel, it's a box of matches. It means strike a piece of wood box, if you translate it literally. Or the squirrel is an Eichhörnchen, which if I translate it literally, it means little one with acorn and horns. Because German squirrels, they look different. They actually have a little bit of fuzz up here, so it looks like horns.
You would express to someone if you're really, really angry, you'll say, Fassefau, which means I'm going to eat you. So it doesn't translate very well. Or some people will say Sefaga, which means like, I'm going to get you, like kind of later on if they can't do it like immediately. To show, express like love or caring, we say Matiamu, which when you translate it means my eyes. So when you talk to your daughter or your son or the person that your significant other, someone you really love, you might say Matiamu instead of saying their name. And it just means my eyes. And when you talk to a little kid, a lot of times you say matakya, because whenever we say akya, usually at the end of stuff, it's something smaller. So we say matakya.
There's crust on a bread, obviously, and then you have like the white fluffy inside of the bread. Like, I don't know if you know a name for that, because I can't think of one. In Albanian, they would say the tul. It's the kore, is the crust, and then the tul would be the white fluffy part of the bread.
Happy New Year, everyone. I mean, Every 31st, everybody greets themselves. Ah, Eku Odun o. Eku Odun o. But when you look at that, it also does not give you the actual translation in English. Eku means you died. Not you alone. E means not just one person. It could be two, it could be three. That's E. Ku, who means die. So how does that translate to Happy New Year? Well, that's what we say, Eku, Odun. Odun is like something you do every year. It's like, could be Christmas, it could be your birthday, something like you feel something that comes with felicitation every that you do every year or specific periods.
I feel like it's the same, like you would just say peace. Because Mexico and the US border each other, I feel like things are shared between some of them. So I feel like, you know, like flipping the bird, I feel like has the same connotation in both countries. Something like peace would have the same thing. So, you know, some gestures are pretty similar, and it's probably from people going back and forth.
In very traditional Mexicans, the way they say peace is they go like this. And that means goodbye, have a good day, see you later.
The word for peace is Frieden. I don't know, I don't think they really have like a peace out or anything. And I don't know if the hand gesture is the same, but Frieden is the word for peace in German.
There is no equivalent for peace. I thought about this. I think we adopted it from Americans.
Well, there's no like, oh, paz, like nobody says that, but because peace in Spanish is paz. There's no like actual paz, but like nos vemos means we'll see you later. Okay. And then a bientôt in French, it means see you later as well.
That's pretty similar. Like they do that. You see Asians all around, I think, always do this. Yeah. So they're doing this. It's not like rabbit ears. It's just peace. They always do that.
I don't remember if there's an actual term for peace, but when we do gesture, it's more the American way we say peace.
A good one for peace would be Om Shanti. And that would just go with the same thing, Om Shanti.
Yeah, we usually just do like something really like casual, like a half wave, and we just say hi, like bye.
Sabaidi. Pache.
Kyubole.
Pas. Yamori pas.
Penyeho. Pas.
Frieden.
Adios.
Alafia.
Alafia from Guayu.
Frieden.
Peace.
Peace.
Abiento. Oh no.